Shalom everybody, Shavua Tov, welcome back. We're continuing with Rabbi Nachman's wisdom, Sichot HaRan in Hebrew, conversation number 141, Kuf Mem Aleph. Before anything, this class is dedicated to the memory of Shaul Yankelevic and the merit of Rabbi Nachman ben Fege. May his neshama have a major aliyah and be included amongst the tzaddikim up there in heaven, and to come to complete rectification of having, well, without having to suffer reincarnations, whatever, Bezat Hashem. Before we start, it's just significant that today happens to be 40 days before Purim, and there is an oral Breslov tradition that Reb Noson said, he stated, that it's proper to already, 40 days before Purim, prepare for Purim. In what sense? In the sense of davening, to have the light of Purim do its job. What's the light of Purim doing its job? This Rabbi Nachman explains, and Reb Noson expounds on it, that we are today are looking to have a modern day Purim miracle, each person on an individual personal level and also on a national level. Which means, just like in Purim, there was an absolute, unbelievable, unexpected miracle from nowhere that no one imagined would be from the way it actually happened. Even Mordechai himself, who Rashi brings down, the Gemara brings down, the Midrash brings down, he knew there was going to be a salvation, but he had no clue how. And it came in the most unexpected, amazing way, in between nature, etc. And that's the big miracle of Purim, that in the nature, God is revealed of doing a major, major breakthrough, and a pure revelation that Hashem is running and controlling the world. So too, we must daven to have such a miracle. So Rav Noson, there's an old tradition, Rav Noson said that 40 days before Purim, it's proper to already cry out to Hashem in prayer, please Hashem, save me from the evil klipa, the evil force and impurity of Haman Amalek, and sanctify me with the light and holiness of Mordechai and Esther. Haman Amalek is the term used not just for the physical nation called Amalek, but all the confusions and doubts and setbacks and failures and difficulties and suffering that a person is going through, and obstacles, etc., etc., all those in that category, they're all under the category of Haman Amalek. He's the one, his spiritual representation in heaven, wherever, is the one behind everything we're going through. And we have the right to push everything on him, even though I can say it's me, I'm at fault and everything. But when a Jew is sincere and he's trying his best to be a good person and to come close, and he has so many obstacles that it becomes impossible to handle, and a person feels he's about to crack and break under the pressure because he has frustration also because he wants to be a good person and it's just not working out. So this we can blame and call it Haman Amalek. And the way out is that we receive upon ourselves a light from a level way above us, which is the light of the tzaddikim. And that's in the request to be sanctified with the light of Mordechai and Esther, because now, especially 40 days before Purim, the light of the holiness of these two tzaddikim, Mordechai and Esther, are shining brighter than any other time of the year, the climax being on Purim itself. But to have that activated, you need preparation. And the preparation is 40 days. Why the number 40? Rav Noson said elsewhere, an oral tradition, that Rav Noson says, by David, the best way to see results and changes in an area is for davening about it for 40 days straight, consecutively. And Rav Noson says, you're guaranteed to see results, changes in life, based on that davening, God willing. So we're hoping that today, 40 days before Purim, where the whole world, nationwide, international-wide, is going nuts and already can't handle with what's happening with this pandemic and epidemic and the corona, etc., what's happening on a national, international level. But personally, the damage caused by all of this, that we have such setbacks in life, physically, spiritually, mentally, emotionally, we need a major, major Purim miracle. That's not to say that we have to wait until Purim for it to happen, but we're now in this period of davening for miracles, so we can put this in as being a part of the locomotive here for the davening. So we're going to continue now with where we left off. We started this class already a while ago. It's a long paragraph, 141. I mean, not so long, but long enough to break it up into a few classes. We're going to continue now to how Rav Noson is explaining in more detail than anywhere else how the 10 chapters known as the Tikkun HaKlali, Rabbi Nachman's Tikkun HaKlali, General Remedy, became revealed. So, continuing where we left off, all right, that Rabbi Nachman in the year 1805 had mentioned the idea of 10 chapters, 10 psalms to rectify the covenant. 10 chapters to do a general remedy. So, Reb Noson continues, Achar kach, achar sha'avru karov le'arba'a shanim. Afterwards, after this incident that took place in 1805, you can say approximately on, if I'm not mistaken, on the 19th, if I'm correct, I think it's the 19th of Sivan. That year was on a Friday. Shavuot. Sorry, I made a mistake. It's the 11th of Sivan. So about 8 days after Shavuot, and it fell on a Friday. So he said, Reb Noson says, approximately after close to 4 years passed, Uma sha'avar be'elu ha'shanim yikzeru rivevot yiriot lesaper. And what transpired in those years, those 4 years, approximately 4 years, nothing will be enough to write on to expound on what happened in those 4 years. So much things happened in Rabbi Nachman's life, in what he revealed, in his teachings, in his following, in his followers. There was so much change in those less than 4 years. Uchvar hayalo acholat shelo shenistalek mimenu. And already at that time, close to 4 years after 1805, after Rabbi Nachman revealed the concept of 10 psalms being the remedy to rectify any sexual blemishes. So he says, and already at this time already, 4 years later, Rabbi Nachman already developed the sickness that he had, that he passed away from, which is tuberculosis. Okay? Uchvar chazar milemberg, and already at this time, approximately 4 years after that Shavuot in 1805, he had already returned from Lvov, Lemberg, for the mysterious reasons Rabbi Nachman traveled to Lemberg. But one thing Rabbi Nachman did there is that he exposed himself. He permitted himself to get medical treatment, but in the end it didn't help. And in the end, he even derided mourned further the medical world at the time. Okay, Uchvar chazar milemberg, pam achat b'chorf shachav al mitato. So again, this is now 4 years later. So much has happened since then. So Reb Noson writes, so it was a winter, approximately 4 years later, Reb Nachman was lying down on his bed. V'anachnu amadnu lefanav, Reb Noson writes, we were standing before Reb Nachman. It's funny, because today, you would think when you go to see like a Rebbe or an important person, you don't find him lying down on his bed. He's at a table, there's no, like an office, an appropriate way to receive people. And here many times, you find Rav Noson's writing, we were standing before him while he was lying down on his bed. So here it's understood because he was very sick. He had tuberculosis. He couldn't now be sitting at a table the whole time. And at the same time, not accept people at all. That wasn't how Rabbi Nachman was. Rabbi Nachman said the whole reason why he came to this world was in order to help the Jewish people come close to Hashem. His whole life was for Am Yisrael. So to just block off people and not to visit, his visiting hours to come at a different time, he was not like that. So if he was lying down in bed and people came to see him, they were let in. And especially people who were super close to Rabbi Nachman, that he wanted them to be there, for sure they were always by him, even when he was lying down in bed. So Reb Noson points out, he was lying down on his bed. V'anachnu amadnu lefanav, sorry, and we were standing in front of him. V'itchil ledaber me'inyan ha'asar kapitul te'elim shem tikkun le'hanav. And he began to speak about the concept of the 10 chapters of Psalms, which are rectification for the sexual blemishes. Ve'az, again, this is approximately 1809, 4 years later, 1808, 1809. And it was at that time, this winter, about 4 years after 1805, so 1809, right? He ordered to me, Rabbi Nachman commanded me to write on paper the verses that are hinting to this concept that the 10 types of song can rectify the above mentioned blemished. Ve'ashavti lichtov umipi v'ikra elai. I sat down to write it down. I had the paper and the ink, and he was dictating to me. He was telling me over what to write. Ve'gilali apsukim, and Rabbi Nachman revealed to me the verses which indicate that these 10 types of song and are the rectification for blemished covenant. And eventually I wrote them, and just like they eventually became printed in the book, Likutei Moran, you can see these 10 verses, these 10 proofs, in Likutei Moran Part 2, Lesson 92. Ve'az gila dato, and it was then in 1809 in the winter, that Rabbi Nachman revealed his wanting, his opinion, what he wanted, his dat, like what he wanted that to happen. Shiratzono legalot bifratiyut ezoem asar kapita teilim shetzichim lomar beoto ayom. He said that it was his will that he wanted to reveal specifically which 10 chapters of Psalms that one has to say on that same day that God forbid a person experiences a nocturnal emission, as mentioned earlier. Vahinu omdim umetzapim shigale lanu, and we were standing there, anticipating and waiting that he should reveal to us the 10 specific chapters. Velo zachinu miyad, but we didn't have the merit immediately for this to take place. It took a while. Achar kach nasanu meito, he didn't reveal it. And then Reb Noson says, then we traveled, we left Breslev, we left him, we traveled from Rabbi Nachman. V'achar kach hayti etzlo beize Shabbat, and it just happened that Reb Noson writes, he came back to spend a Shabbat, it doesn't specify which one, by Rabbi Nachman. V'hizmin Hashem Yidbarach shera'iti be'einai k'tivat yadu ha'kdosho, and it turned out Hashem made things work out that I saw with my own eyes in Rabbi Nachman's own handwriting, שכבר רשם לעצמו עשרה קפיטות תהילים, that he had already marked down, he had written down and marked down for himself which are the 10 specific chapters of Tehillim שצריכים לומר, the one that one has to say as part of the Tikkun HaKlali. אך, look what Reb Noson writes, amazing, לא היה מדרך ארץ שאקח כתב ידו בעצמי בלי רשותו. However, it was not proper, it was not out of proper moral conduct, derech eretz, that I take his own handwriting copy, you know, on my own without his permission. You know, if he would give me permission, it's one thing. But here, I just happened to be in his room, and I saw what he wrote. And so Reb Noson writes, he was like a lot under stress and a lot of anxiety here. Veratziti litofsam b'mochi be'alpe, and I wanted to grasp them by memory, just by looking at the verses and trying to remember what the numbers were, 16, you know, 32, 41, 42. Velo yacholti mechamat emat rabbi pen yakpid, but I couldn't. I was so over preoccupied by the worry of the anxiety. What if he catches me? Because don't forget, Rabbi Nachman is someone who could read people's minds. He already proved that in many several places you can find in the book Tzaddik and elsewhere. He was able to read people's minds. He knew what they were thinking about. So Reb Noson had this on his conscience. What if he knows that I already grasped him, and he didn't reveal to me explicitly, so it's not right. He probably doesn't want me to do that. So Reb Noson writes, I couldn't, because of what the conscious, I had this on my conscience of the worry and the anxiety, I couldn't grasp it off by heart, because I had fear of my Rebbe, perhaps he will take it to issue why I, without permission, memorized the 10 actual numbers of the Psalms. Kibati, because Reb Noson explains what happened at that Shabbat. Kibati lechadro matzati ktav yado hanal vistakalti bo belo reshuto. Because I came into his room, his private room, and I found his handwriting of the 10 Psalms open there, and I looked at it without his permission. He writes in brackets of Nosim, Ki ha-ma'aseh hazot ha-ita b'Shabbat parashat shkalim, shnat taka lifrat katan. This incident that happened here, of going into his room on Shabbat, which Shabbat, what was it? So this took place on Shabbat parashat shkalim, the year 1810, lifrat katan. Okay? 1810. Shehu Zal yatza mechadro v'nichnas labayit hagadol shelo be'et kriyat haTorah, that he, Rabbi Nachman of blessed memory, went out of his room and went into the bigger room where they were davening at the time of the kriyat haTorah in order to hear the parashat shkalim. V'az nichnasti bechadro v'ra'iti ktav yado anal. When Rabbi Nachman went into the kriyat haTorah, Rabbi Nosson says, and I went into his room, when he went out to hear the reading of the Torah, I went into his room and I saw his handwriting in itself. You can see already that there's a bit of a contradiction, because earlier he said 1809, And here it's already 1810. So you see that time transpired between when Rabbi Nachman said he would have liked to reveal it, and that was in 1809. And this incident here of Noson seeing it written, and he had no idea what they were, took place approximately a year later in 1810, which is less than a year before Rabbi Nachman passed away. His last year in Breslov was 1810, before he moved to Uman on the 5th of Iyar, in the summer of 1810. ואחר כך, ביום ראשון, בעת שלקחתי רשותו מאיתו לשוב לביתי, Reb Noson closed the brackets, and he's continuing in the story here. And afterwards, on Sunday, when Reb Noson says, I went to receive permission from him to go back home, because that's the custom, that when you are by a big tzaddik, you ask reshut, permission to leave, to be able to leave. דיברתי עמו ושאלתי ממנו שיגלה לי עשר קפיטל הנ"ל. I spoke to Rabbi Nachman, and I asked him, please reveal to me the 10 chapters of the Tikkun HaKlali. Ki yadati shekvar hem nirshamim etzlo kanal. Because I knew already, he had it written down. I knew that he had written down, they had already written down the 10 actual specific chapters. Ve'lo ratza, yet Rabbi Nachman did not want to reveal them to me. Ve'amar sheye et acher lazeh, and he said there will be another time for this to happen. והלכתי מיתו, and Reb Noson writes, and I left. I went back home to Nemirov. אחר כך, סמוך לאותה העת, בעת שהייתי אני בביתי בנמירוב. So afterwards, close to that time, while I was still at home in Nemirov, my hometown Nemirov, Reb Noson writes, אז גילה העשרה קפיטל תהילים לפני הרב דפו ברסלב, ולפני חברי רבי נפתלי מנמירוב. So it was at that time when I was away from Rabbi Nachman, Reb Noson writes, that Rabbi Nachman revealed the 10 specific chapters of the Tehillim before the halachic rabbi of the city, the village of Breslov, that's Rabbi Aharon Goldstein, the Rav of Breslov, who was a student of Rabbi Nachman, and before Reb Noson writes, my dear friend, Rabbi Naftali Weinberg, who was from Nemirov, who was at the time by Rabbi Nachman in Breslov. וייחד אותם לעדות על זה. And he revealed the 10 specific psalms, and he set them aside, these two people, to be witnesses on this. Okay, on what? The following. וכך אמר להם, this is what Rabbi Nachman said. So at the same time, he revealed to them which 10 specific chapters, and he revealed the upcoming famous oath that Rabbi Nachman swore to take. Okay, he said like this, Rabbi Nachman, starting with these words. היות בעניין זה הידוע, wow, since in this thing which is known, he's speaking in a very modest term, what is he referring to? With this concept which is known, what? What's known? Reb Noson adds in brackets, היינו עניין מקרה לילה חס ושלום. In other words, the idea, the situation, the scenario of having a nocturnal emission, a sexual transgression, God forbid. נלכדים בוודאי שלושה חלקי העולם. Definitely, this is Rabbi Nachman's time in 1810. Definitely, 3/4 of the world have fallen into this. Now, when he's talking about the world, he's talking about the Jewish world. Because by the Gentiles, there's no problem whatsoever of the person having masturbation or, God forbid, having an emission. By them, there's no rules and regulations by that, unfortunately. Maybe certain sects of religions, but in the populace, in the main, that's part of Gentile attitude of having sexual openness. But by the Jewish people, where it's a clear prohibition, that's something different. So he says, Rabbi Nachman, by the Jewish world, definitely in his time already, 3/4 of men in his time, 1810, are trapped and have fallen in this problem of having emissions. Okay? Again, emissions due to sexual fantasies and thoughts that afterwards are in the subconscious, like we spoke about many times, they are used to attack a person while he's asleep. So in a sense, it's unintentional because he's asleep. What do you want from him? But it's intentional because he allowed these thoughts into his head. And Rabbi Nachman said in his time, when 3/4 of people in his time were fallen and trapped in this area. So he said, Rabbi Nachman, since this is the case, אני לוקח אתכם לעדות, I, Rabbi Nachman, I'm taking you, these two people, Rabbi Aaron and Rabbi Naftali, as testimony, as witnesses, v'tedu, and you should know, and I'm again witnesses that I said this, she'elu ha'asara kapitul tehilim Mo'ilim me'od me'od le'tikun keri, that these 10 chapters of Tehillim help tremendously, help very, very much to rectify the damage caused by wasted seed. Vehem, look at this wording, it's unbelievable, like he said in the Likutei Moran itself in lesson 205. Vehem, but here it's even more. Vehem tikkun gamur u'mo'il me'od me'od. And these 10 chapters of Psalms, these specific 10 chapters, are a complete rectification and help very, very much. To be continued, Bezat Hashem, in the next class.